You are watching the official worship cast of Journey of Life Church in Orlando, Florida. Visit us on the internet at journeyoflife.org.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. Thank you for coming. We've been in a cafeteria for a long time now. It's just important to take a moment and to put aside the past, and put aside the future, and put aside whatever is not right here, and to just be here for 1 hour. Whatever else is going to grab your mind, you can't get to, because there's no cell service in here. So we're going to take a moment and pray kind of a sentient prayer, and just be here with God and the Holy Spirit moving for whatever God wants to do in our lives. Father in heaven, we are thankful to be able to be here this morning. We are thankful for your love and good news of Jesus Christ. We know that your love covers all. Your relationship is with the world in love, and yet it's also with each of us through your Holy Spirit. We know you have good in your heart for us, desire the very best for each of us. And so we ask that you would help us center here, just to be with you as we sing, as we contemplate your word, as we pray, as we celebrate your Holy Supper. Make this our time with you, in Jesus' name. Let's stand for us.
Forever I love you, forever I'll stand.
what we're going to think about together today, comes very, very early in Jesus' ministry. It's in Mark chapter 1, and it's where Jesus heals a man with an unclean spirit. It's Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, because he taught them as one who had authority, not like the scribes teach. And immediately there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him, and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed. And so they questioned among themselves even more, saying, "What is this? A new teaching, and with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once Jesus' fame spread everywhere throughout all of the surrounding region of Galilee.
So,
then what happens? What happens to me? Remember? Jesus says, basically he says, be quiet and get out. The demon starts shrieking and he says, be quiet and get out. And what do you think the demon did? He was quiet and he got out. Because Jesus has real power. That's why. And so when I read this, I'll tell you what I learned from this. I learned. Hey, you're wrong. So what I learned from this, you got a very comfortable lesson. What I learned from this is that there is nothing that I can't trust Jesus to handle. Because if Jesus can come up and tell a demon, be quiet and get out, and the demon has to obey him, he can handle anything else in my life. Because you're going to have some things that are really happy and some things that are really hard happening. And this guy had a really hard thing, right? The demon on the inside of him. And what he learned is that Jesus can be there. And so we can have hope no matter what happens in our life. Because we always know that Jesus is with us. Alright? Let's can go to the children's church with Mrs. Kelly.
Capernaum
is a big city. In fact, there are different designations for a village in a city. City being a big place, right? And Capernaum's always called a city. In fact, Capernaum was big enough that it had a Roman garrison stationed there with 100 people. And we know that because we know later on that we hear about a Roman centurion, which is a Roman officer in charge of 100 people. So we know there's at least about 100 soldiers in Capernaum. So there's 100 soldiers. That's a big city. It's a very, very substantial city. So that's where Jesus goes. And it turns out, at least one of the synagogues was pretty new because the Romans built a synagogue there for the people, and we'll probably get to that in a few weeks. So that's Capernaum. Big city, Roman garrison, lots of intercultural stuff. Definitely not a distinctly Jewish city at all. And Jesus goes there, and he's teaching in the synagogue. So I want to talk about what synagogues are for just a moment. And the word synagogue actually means assembly. It means gathering together. It's like the word church. Church doesn't actually mean a building. It means an assembly. And the building, the church building, came to be called the church because it's the place where the assembly happens. So we are church, even though we don't have a church building, because we are an assembly of people learning from and following Christ. The synagogue in Jesus' time was a fairly simple affair, really. It was basically the town meeting hall, and then every Saturday, every Sabbath, the Jewish people would gather in the synagogue for a very simple service. And there would be a little bit of teaching there. Some of the synagogues we found have like kind of tiered benches, and some of them have broad, flat floors. None of them are too big. None of them are too big. One of them is 36 feet by 45 feet that we found. A big one in Capernaum appears to have, the whole building was 75 feet long. So in terms of, think about the size of the people build churches today. 75 feet long is not very big in terms of how big people build churches. So they're not terribly big buildings. And the reason is because they're supposed to be community centers, and they functioned that way. They held other functions during the week, and their Sabbath time was centered really around the hearing of the word and teaching. There wasn't a lot of ritual at all there. They might have judicial proceedings that sit there. It actually ordered people to be flogged. Good thing you put that one way off. I don't want that responsibility. There was officers. There was basically a head of the synagogue. There was a board of elders. There was a person who collected the alms for the poor. And then there was an attendant who was in charge of all the scriptures. So it's not really like the church we have today with all the ritual tradition, especially that some churches honor and celebrate. That happened later. They had a simple service. Started with what's called the Great Shema. And if you talk to anybody of Jewish persuasion, even secular Jews will know what the Great Shema is. Shema is a Hebrew word. It means hear. And the Great Shema is a piece of scripture that starts with, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength." And it goes on for a few more sentences. So then we start, I just want to paint this picture in your head so we can kind of get into where the miracle happened. So the synagogue service would start with the blowing of the shofar, or the ram's horn. So someone would stand up and... I didn't even practice it. And then they would recite the Great Shema, and then there would be some short synagogue prayers. They would have two readings, one from the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It's called the Torah. And then they would have another reading from one of the prophets. And then somebody who's a teacher would stand up and kind of expound and sermonize on the readings, and then they'd have a benediction. And that's the whole thing. So it was a very simple service. The synagogues actually weren't part of, when you think of Israel, But I do too. I typically think of the time under King David and all that stuff, right? They didn't have synagogues back then because everything was centered around this temple. Near as we can tell, the synagogues kind of developed out of times where the Jews were in captivity, like in Babylon, and they needed to preserve their teaching. So they formed the synagogue system. You had to have at least 10 Jewish males to form a synagogue. The Talmud, the Jewish writing, estimates that there were about 80 synagogues in the city of Jerusalem at the time of Jesus. So, yeah, I can see that for you. I can see some of you like that. But that's what it says. And so that tells you, again, that synagogue is a real, it's more of a learning and following community than a giant worshiping center, right? Because if there's that many packed into a city, there's, you know, only going to be a certain number of families that can fit in these smallish buildings. So that's what a synagogue was, and that's where Jesus was teaching. And this kind of community that everybody knew each other, and they had other meetings in the building during the week and stuff. And Jesus is teaching. So now we have to put ourselves in this building. You're in the synagogue. You've already heard the show far below. I'm not going to do that again. And it says he taught with authority. Now, this word authority is, there's several different words for authority. This one is exousia. That's the Greek word, exousia. Say that with me, exousia. Is that? I'm here to listen. But this word, it means like the legitimate power to command. Exousia is the one who has jurisdiction over something. So that's, when they say Jesus taught with power, he taught like someone who is actually in charge. Like one who knows, not like the scribes. I teach more like the scribes. I'm like, well, I think it might mean this, and I think it might mean this, and I'm not sure about that. We certainly don't know much about that, but we do know more about this. And then Jesus comes along and he teaches like one whose rightful place is to stand up in front and tell everybody how things really are. He teaches like the one who has jurisdiction to teach. And then the man comes with an unclean spirit. So picture yourself, they're already noticing. Picture yourself sitting there listening to Jesus teach, and you're already noticing that he teaches differently. And I don't know if you've ever had people in your life that teach differently. There's some people, some teachers, when they teach, they kind of teach out of the book or whatever, right? They do a fine job, and I'm not dissing them at all. But then you go to a certain lecture with a certain professor or whatever who has been steeped in whatever he's doing for like 40, 50 years, or she's doing for like 40, 50 years. And they don't look at the book. They don't know how to notes. They don't have anything. They just walk up there, and they start telling you the way their subject is. They speak with authority. That's how Jesus is speaking. They're like, dang, this guy really knows. There's a power and a sense of authority to what he says. And then the guy comes in with the evil spirit. And Jesus, and so they're thinking Jesus is speaking with authority. And the guy comes in with the evil spirit. And Jesus says, be quiet and get out. And the evil spirit does it. And then can you imagine if he's kind of teaching, you're like resonating with what he's saying, like, wow, he kind of knows what he's talking about. And then a person with a demon comes in and he says to the demon, shut up and get out. And the demon shuts up and gets out. And the guy sits down and Jesus goes on teaching. Would you be listening to that man? I would be listening to that man. That would reinforce my sense of his authority. And this is where this reading really challenged me. It kind of hit me in the face. Because some of you who have been in other parts of the world, Haiti and Africa and things, may have experienced different things than me, but I don't live in a world where someone comes in with an evil spirit who's like trash-talking God. Now, I did encounter one guy in Jerusalem who very well could have been but that's the only one in my entire life, and that was just a little creepy. It wasn't like this. And so this reading really challenged me because I'm like, that's You know, it's nice to read it in Scripture, but it's not the world I live in. That's not what happens in my life. And so I started thinking about it, and I thought, you know, if someone else told me that, I would be skeptical, let's just say. It doesn't feel like what a pastor should be. Nonetheless, it's what I am. I'm skeptical when people tell me of miraculous things, because a lot of it just kind of seems like a coincidence to me. But this is not something that can be explained away. Either it happened, either I'm going to believe what the Bible says or I'm not. So I can't really deny this. And further, I can't even blame it on Mark, because it's recorded in Luke also, and Luke begins in his preamble saying, I sat down to write a carefully researched account of everything that happened. And so Luke includes this too. So now, basically, I just have to say, well, this happened. I have to say, well, there are evil spirits, because it can't be a sickness, right? If the guy comes in and he's just acting crazy, that can be mental illness. But if the guy comes in and says, I know who you are, you're the Holy One of God, have you come here to torture me? And then Jesus says, show up and get out from the evil spirit, and he does. Then I have to sort of take that, and I have to add it to my worldview. I have to say, well, that doesn't fit in my experience, but I have to add it to my worldview. And that's a really good thing for all of us. To be hit in the face with things we don't understand that we don't normally encounter and have to add them to our worldview. I was watching a documentary. Anybody seen the documentary Life? BBC? There's a thing called a stick-eye fly that will also slap you in the face with its weirdness. Here's what happens. It's on the floor of the jungle. And it crawls out of its little shell or whatever that it's been forming in. And it looks like jelly with legs when it crawls out. And two eyes on the side of its head, okay? So it's a little ant kind of thing crawling out of there with two eyes on the side of its head. And it crawls, and it has, the first thing it has to get off the jungle floor, because that's not safe. So it crawls up a tree, onto a branch, until it finds safety, okay? You got in your mind, this is a bug made out of Vaseline with two eyes right here. And here's what it does. And you might want to even just look this up on YouTube, because it's so amazing. So it gets up on the branch, and then it starts gulping in air and blowing it into the base of where the eyes are attached to the head. Okay, are you good? And then they go like this. And then he does more. And the eyes go bigger. And bigger. And literally, the eyes end up on stalks that are probably two-thirds the length of the entire bug. And then it looks like a cat. He kind of grooms them out, straightens them out and everything. And all this time, the body's starting to solidify. And by the time he's done, he's got two eyes on the end of two long sticks, and it's all solidified. And then he crawls around starting to look for a mate, and the mating challenge is whosoever eyes are wider set. whoever has the wider set eyes is the one who gets the girl. I'm glad that I'm not that yet. So that I was like, really, it blows bubbles into its head and forces its eyes out. That's crazy. So and life has all these kind of things that happen. And when we don't get ourselves slapped in the face once in a while by reality beyond our expectation, our worlds can become calcified. Our point of view can become limited. We can end up sitting in boxes of our own making. I met a guy named Marshall, I got to know Marshall over a three-day retreat. Marshall seemed perfectly sane. We had a great time together. Never once said anything that was remotely disconnected with reality. And then we were in the hotel bar last night having a drink, and we were talking. And I his Christianity had come up. So I said, you know, tell me more about yourself. Turns out he was raised a Lutheran, he's not Lutheran anymore. And he told me he walked away from the church because it just felt dead, you know. Felt dead. And then he met a couple people and they took him to this other church. And something stirred inside of his soul. And so he started going to that church. And he was hanging with the pastor one day, and they got a call that someone had died in a nursing home. So we went over there. And there was the body, all the stuff had been disconnected and everything. And evidently he looked at the body and decided it wasn't time for that person to be dead. And so he just kind of put his hand on her, and he said, come on back. Come on back, it's not time for you to go. In Jesus' name, come on back. No, nothing, nobody's dancing, nobody's screaming at the top of their lungs. Marshall said he was eating a sandwich while he was praying. Come on back, Arlen. It's not time. You know where this goes, right? The eyes open, and the focus sits up. What are you going to do with that? What am I going to do with that? Because that doesn't happen to me, and yet it happens to people, right? So it has to slap me in the face and say, it has to make me think of a larger principle of my life and the way I'm looking at things and the way I'm walking through my life and the way I am the way I'm living my life and the way I'm looking at things. And to pull it. So what I want to do is I don't want to talk about miracles as such anymore. What I want to talk to you about is a larger principle of openness to life. And I want to ask you to think about whether you're open to life, whether you're open to new things, new power maybe that you haven't experienced, new places to go. Here's the thing. People are deeply, deeply conditionable. We all are. Everybody is. We are conditioned by reality. Although there's the map. Too late for that slide. I've got a slide here, and it's funny. But watch this. Watch the cat. She steps over the barrier. There's no barrier, but okay. Is that awesome? Take our cues from the people around us. And if nobody around us has experienced power, like someone being raised from the dead, then we don't live in a world where people get raised from the dead. All of a sudden I talked to Marshall, and Marshall was standing next to a guy who's eating a sandwich going, come on back, darling. And the woman's spirit came back to her body and she was raised. And now I can either just ignore that, or I have to incorporate it. I can ignore it, and I don't want to be the person who just ignores reality. That doesn't seem very healthy to me. There was a trial, they did an experiment with monkeys. They put some fruit on the top of a pole. And every time the monkeys would climb up the pole to get the fruit, they'd squirt it with water. And pretty soon, the monkeys all learned not to climb the pole, as you would expect, right? So, here's what they did. Then they put a new monkey in there. The new monkey saw the fruit on the top of the pole. What do you think that monkey did? Try to go get the fruit, right? The other monkeys, what do you think they did? They tried to stop them. They grabbed them. They pulled them down and all that, and just kept them. And finally, that monkey learned that he was not allowed to climb the pole. He didn't know why. All he knew was the other monkeys taught him not to climb the pole. Slowly, they replaced all the monkeys in the room. One by one, until there was no monkey who had ever been squirted by water. And then they put another monkey in there. And what do you think those other monkeys did with the new monkey? They kept him from climbing the pole. And the room was filled with monkeys who had never, ever been squirted with water for climbing the pole. But they had learned from their friends, who had learned from their friends, not to climb the pole or something bad would happen. And episodes like this make me think, Am I in the position of those monkeys? Have I been taught things that aren't actually true by other people who believe them to be true, maybe based on their experience, but it wouldn't be true of my experience? So the question is, how have you been conditioned? How have you been conditioned to be closed off to new possibilities, new power? Where do you feel like, maybe, there's no power in your life? Where do you feel like there's no hope? Where do you feel like you may be backed up against a barrier or trapped in a dead end? Maybe you're, I don't know, for those of us who have jobs, maybe it's your job. Maybe that's starting to feel like a dead end, you're trapped. Maybe there's a family relationship that just, it's a tangled mess, and it just, or it's just like completely separated, and you feel like it's done, and you try a couple times or whatever, and so you're done with it. Maybe it's your personal growth. Maybe you feel like you've got some things you're just never going to get over. It's not going to happen for you. You're just stuck. You are who you are, and that's going to keep happening to you. Maybe it's your health. Here's another way to say it. Where have you lost? Where in your life have you lost hope? Because here's the thing. If you've lost hope, you're going to act differently than if you have hope. And quite often, we get whatever we're expecting to get. Henry Ford, why am I quoting him a sermon? I don't know, because he said something that's good. Whether you think you can or you think you can't, you are right, most probably. Whether you're open or closed to a possibility of in one of these areas where you feel like you're at a dead end, in a cul-de-sac or whatever, whether you're open or closed to the possibility of change, healing, growth, peace, your own attitude about whether or not you're open or closed has a large influence on whether or not that can take place. And it's like the monkeys. Other people have influenced us or told us whether or not there's hope or not. And what do they know? But here's what happened to Jesus. It was in Nazareth, as a matter of fact. It's in Mark chapter 6. It says he could do no mighty work there in Nazareth, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And Jesus marveled at their lack of faith. Jesus marveled at their lack of faith. He couldn't do any work there because there was no one who would believe that he could. Let me say that again. When you think about that, he couldn't do any work because they didn't believe in him. So where are you closed off in your life? Where's there no sense of possibility? Where's there no hope? Where can you not conceive of actually having peace somewhere? Or healing, or growth, or love, or reconciliation? This episode here, this episode with the guy walking in with a demon and walking out healed, it reminds me of what Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 19, verse 26. With God, all things are possible. I haven't read a Bible passage in a while that dealt with Jesus and evil spirits and stuff. And so this passage, for me, it kind of cracked my evil spirit box open again. It made me wonder what other boxes I have built for myself. I wonder what boxes you have built for yourself. Where have you lost hope? Paul wrote to the Romans about hope. Usually we lose hope when we're suffering, right? We don't lose hope when things are going well. How many of you lose hope when things are going well? No. Romans 5, 3-5, Paul talks about our suffering. He says not only that, we rejoice in our sufferings. Now that takes faith. We rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, whom he has given to us. Paul writes to the Corinthians, there's three basic things in life: faith and hope and love. The greatest, of course, is love, but there's three: faith and hope and love. So where is your hope? Where have you lost hope? Where do you need to have your hope box cracked open again? Because Jesus said, with God, all things are possible. So what do I know? What do I know about this? What do I know about our lives? What do I know about God working in our lives? I know that God doesn't heal everybody all the time in this earth. I know that God doesn't rescue us from all our difficult times. I know that God doesn't heal every relationship that we would like to be healed. But I do know that God's love and grace are poured out on us. I do know that God is not holding anything against any of us. That's all done. Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection puts that to rest. Whatever's happening is not because God is getting revenge on you or something. I know God is causing all things to work for good for those who love and are called according to his purpose. And so what I know is there's never a good enough reason to give up hope because God is still at work. We can live confidently. We can live like openly and try to, and when we're sensing that we've found another edge of a box that we built for ourselves, we can dare to begin to peek open that box and say, what walls have I built around myself? Where are my preconceived notions and my prejudices built a box in my life? We can take emotional risks for reconciliation and personal growth. We can be wrong, and it's okay. So what assumptions are you living by that might not be right? What box have you or me put ourselves in? And are we willing to peek out? Could things get better in ways we don't expect as God works in our lives? Our relationships maybe be healed? Could that gnawing sense that just bugs me in my spirit finally be put to rest and give me peace? Could your job get better? Could your kids finally find their way in life and quit feeling like they're so far off track? There is no promise that things will not at times be difficult and painful, but there's never a good enough reason to give up hope. Because God's love and power are larger than we can imagine. So today's message is to think about where you might have closed the door of hope, healing, growth, change, peace, and love, to maybe open that door again today in faith, because we know God is working. I just want to close with a blessing that Paul wrote to the Christians of Thessalonians. It's in 2 Thessalonians 2, 16, 17. And he says this, and I say this to you. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and deed. Let's pray. Father, you have shown us in Jesus the power to command even the spiritual forces that for many of us we've never at least encountered in a manifest way, like a clear, visible way, like someone possessed by the Holy Spirit. But still, Jesus' power, even over that, should remind us, help it remind us, that he has power over our lives. And if we don't know how you're working, we don't always know where you're working, but we always know that you are working and causing things to work together for good. Father, some of us have lost hope so much that we don't even realize we've lost hope. We just think that's the way life is. What I'm asking you for everybody here is to show each of us where we have embraced some sort of no hope attitude. Because then we act like there's no hope. So crack us open, Lord, and show us new hope where we feel like there's none. And let us step forward in faith, expecting you to be working, even if we don't know where and how that will happen. Give us faith that builds new hope for us. In Jesus' name. And he's going to come up and sing a song for us. And while he does, you can take a few moments to reflect on that. Maybe take a couple of notes, because we'll write this down if you remember them. How many of you want to remember something, and then you didn't write it down, and then you're like, oh, what's that? Oh, what's that? Right? I mean, everybody does that. So write something down if there's something you need to write down. Write it down. Also, you can come up and bring your offerings and prayer cards. If you'd like me to pray out loud during the service, if you would do me the favor of putting them on the altar right here, everything else can just go in the offering plates over there, offerings and prayer cards. And feel free to get up and stretch or whatever you need to do. If you feel comfortable, take a break, and then we'll gather again to celebrate the Lord's Supper after the afternoon.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sin. As a called and ordained representative of Jesus Christ, I tell you confidently in his name, all your sin is forgiven. God is not holding anything against you. Be at peace.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Let us pray for the people of God and all people everywhere, according to their needs.
We join together to pray to our gracious Heavenly Father.
Father, we want to thank you that your love, forgiveness, and grace pour down on us freely. That you assure us in Jesus, you don't look at us like the judge of the universe, but like the Father who looks at his children, desiring the best for us. And so now we come to you at your invitation to talk to you about our lives. We ask you to bring comfort to Larry and his family as he goes through treatment for his leukemia. We would also pray for his healing. We also want to pray for healing for Chuck as his lymphoma has returned. We continue our prayers for health and healing and peace for Brad Tibbs and Don Olmsted and John Burhau. We pray for Barbara and Ralph who are walking the road of dementia, and we pray for their family members to have patience and peace with them. We continue to pray for healing for Frank's headaches. We pray for the mission and ministry workers that are close to our hearts, for Tom and Marilyn, Wayne Grace, Mike and Leanne, David and Ruth. We pray for our servicemen and women overseas in armed forces and in all different capacities to protect them, keep them safe, especially those who have to use force in the carrying out of their duties, keep their hearts safe and peace. We pray for all people everywhere in the persecution that you would release them. We pray for the persecutors that you would grant them repentance so they can see the error of their ways. And we pray for our Christian brothers and sisters that you would give them a miracle of power of the Holy Spirit that they can express love even to those who are persecuting them. We pray for local ministries we support, for the Prince of Peace Food Pantry, for Kairos Prison Ministry, for the Central Florida Children's Home. We pray for the Adesi family as they fight the flu and pneumonia. Father, just drive that infection out of their body and bring them back to full health. We want to also pray for our other first responders in every area, that you would guide them, keep them safe on the job, and that guard their spirits from the pain that often goes with helping people in times of difficulty. We pray for the leaders of our country, that you would give them wisdom to guide our country according to your will. But more than anything, we pray for people who don't know that all is forgiven in Jesus, that you are not holding anything against us, that you have reconciled us to yourself, and that you want the best for us. We pray that we can, each of us, in our own way, according to your calling on our lives, participate in sharing of that news with the world and with the people around us that we talk to. We also want to pray for organizations that are directly involved in that, the Wycliffe Associates and Crew, the Lutheran Bible Translators. All these things we lift up to you, Father, and we read them in your care. In the name of Jesus our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed to the bread, and when he gave the thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he gave thanks, he passed it to his disciples and said, drink of this all of you. This cup is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, Now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
Please be seated. A couple of quick logistic items. The way we celebrate here is that we just kind of go row by row. There's no ushers. And I'll be here with the bread. And then you can approach the altar and either dip your latte in the stoneware cup from the center, or you can take a sip of one of the gold-colored cups on either edge of the altar. We don't decide who takes communion. We say this is the what Jesus said. This is his body and blood for our forgiveness and life, and we offer it to all and everybody who would like to participate. Welcome this morning. Let's take a moment of prayer. Father, you have given us this meal. It's a sacred meal. You proclaimed it. Your son Jesus proclaimed it to be his body and blood. And churches throughout the world have celebrated this meal for almost 2,000 years. And so we are connected to a very wide community across space and time. Father, help us to sense that connection, that love, that brother and sisterhood across all space and time of all who look to you for forgiveness and peace and power for life. Father, use this meal to strengthen our faith in you and our love for one another and all your creation. In Jesus' name. Welcome to the Lord's Day.
This is the body. This is the soul. Broken and poured out for all.
Father, feed us in every way, our spirits, our bodies. you love us enough to come to us through all our senses, not just through our ears and our eyes, but through our smell and our taste and our touch. You proclaim your love for us in every way. Father, give us faith to believe that love, and to believe all the possibility that love brings to our lives. Help us go away today with a great hope. In Jesus' name. Announcements. Anybody have any announcements? Panera Bread.
A bunch of sweets.
A lot of them.
It's a big sweet day. They seem to go back and forth. Like, yeah. There's a lot of bread. There's a lot of sweets.
The bread too, but mostly.
Excellent. And for those of you who are visitors, Panera gives us that the night before. They're going to throw it away, so instead of that, they give it away. And so take as much as you want. That's what it's there for. Anybody else have any announcements? Okay. Let's stand and sing our closing.
So that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in peace.